In Mark chapter 2, verse 26, I have it here, that it's written during the time of Abiathar, the high priest. So in this case, Jesus is on the Sabbath with the disciples and they're collecting grain or wheat, whatever the case may be. The Pharisees accost him and they say, well, why are you doing this? Why are you not fasting? Why are you breaking the Sabbath? Basically, they say to, he says to them, Jesus says to them, have you not read or learned about what David did during the time of Abiathar, who was the high priest? Turns out, Abiathar was not the high priest at the time of David. So to be sure here, it was actually Abiathar's father, Ahimelech, who was the high priest at this time. And it's written in the Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 21, verses 1 to 8. And again, a second time in 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse 20. And so it's actually mentioned that this is a contradiction and they can't reconcile it.
This is not a historical contradiction, but a failure to apply reading comprehension. 1 Samuel 21:1 is correct in stating the priest was Ahimelech. On the other hand, neither was Jesus wrong. Epi in Mark 2:26 is defined by lexicons such as Bauer, Donker, Art, and Gingrich to simply mean in the time of, at, on, or for. It is best translated as in the days of or in the time of because it is part of the genitive case here, and this is the consistent genitive translation in the New Testament, such as we see in Acts 11:28. One could say in the days of King David to refer to this event regarding the showbread or any event that happened contemporarily with David prior to him ruling as king. In other words, we can refer to David as King David in association with this event, even though this event happened before he actually became a king. Similarly, if someone were to speak of the Christians imprisoned in the days of Paul the Apostle, it would be understood as referring to the time before Paul was actually an apostle, even though we leave the qualifier attached to his name to distinguish who is being spoken of. Thus, we can refer to Paul as Paul the Apostle, even though we are speaking of an event that took place prior to his conversion and apostleship. Thus, Mark 2:26 contains a perfectly normal and accurate statement. Jesus could rightly say, in the time of Abiathar, the high priest, whether he was high priest yet or not yet.
I want to point out one other thing that the scholars have mentioned, which is if you read the two genealogies, again, they say they don't just differ in the number of people, but they also differ in the names, identity, and the identities of these people. So either Luke had a bad source or Matthew did, or potentially both were just making it up as they go along. Who knows at this point?
E.F. Dawa and Ijaz think there is a contradiction between Matthew and Luke's genealogy. In response, we simply point out the obvious, namely, that there are two genealogies, and that should be expected since there are two different lines of ancestors. One traced through his legal father, Joseph, and the other through his actual mother, Mary. Matthew gives the official line, emphasizing the Jewish Messiah's credentials, because Jews believed that the Messiah would come from the seed of Abraham and the line of David. Luke, with a broader Greek audience in view, presented Jesus as the perfect man, which was the quest of Greek thought. Thus, he traces Jesus back to the first man, Adam, Luke 3:38. And that Matthew gives Jesus his paternal genealogy and Luke's his maternal genealogy is further supported by several facts. While both trace Christ to David, each is through a different son of David. Matthew traces Jesus through Joseph, his legal father, to David's son, Solomon the king, by whom Christ rightfully inherited the throne of David, 2 Samuel 7:12. However, Luke's purpose, on the other hand, is to show Christ as an actual human, so he traces Christ to David's son, Nathan, through his actual mother, Mary, through whom he can rightfully claim to be fully human, the Redeemer of humanity. Finally, the fact that the two genealogies have some names in common, such as Shealtiel and Zerubbabel, does not prove they are the same genealogy for two reasons. Number one, these are not uncommon names, and number two, even the same genealogy, Luke's in case, has a repeat of the names Joseph and Judah, such as we see in verse 26 and 23. Thus, there is no contradiction.
From what I understand, biblical scholars think that because Jesus was known as Jesus of Nazareth, so everyone knew he was like from a town or place called Nazareth. So how is it that Jesus could have been born in Bethlehem? Matthew wanted to explain that kind of discrepancy, and so he has Jesus being born in Bethlehem, but eventually ending up in Nazareth.
There's no discrepancy whatsoever. He was born in Bethlehem, but grew up in Nazareth. So the issue is, why was he called a Nazarene then? Well, first, consider how the names of cities have occasionally been used to represent a particular idea. The inhabitants of Corinth were so sexually immoral that the verb Corinthiaso, to Corinthianize or to act like Corinthians, meant to commit sexual immorality. In regard to Nazareth, the city had a reputation of being rather insignificant. Thus, the words in John 1:46 shed light on this. Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said, "Come and see." So, to come from Nazareth or to be called a Nazarene was the same as to be despised. And the fact is, the Old Testament prophets foretold the Messiah would be a despised root out of dry ground, similar to how cities such as Sodom and Gomorrah have been used to describe a particular activity, i.e. vile wickedness. Matthew assigned the term Nazarene to Jesus to adequately express the prophet's prediction of his lowly, despised origins. So, this is not a contradiction because the text does not say he would be born in Nazareth, but describes him growing up in Nazareth after being born in Bethlehem.
Mark says that Jesus was born at a time when Herod was ruling, yeah? Let me just put it very, very sort of straightforwardly.
Yeah.
And Luke says, now this is when Quirinius was the governor of Syria, which would have included the area of Palestine. The difference in that is a timing of, let's say, approximately 10 years. Yeah.
This is not an either-or scenario and can be reconciled several ways. Let's take a look at one. In stating that Quirinius controlled the Syrian area, Luke doesn't use the official political title of governor or legatus, but the broader term hegemon, translated to be in charge of and would refer to a ruling officer or procurator. This means that Quirinius may not have been the official governor of Judea, but was in charge of the census because he was a more capable and trusted servant of Rome. Justin Martyr supports this view in his First Apology, chapter 34, writing that Quirinius was a procurator, not a governor of the area of Judea. Also, there is a famous inscription in honor of a man who was twice governor of Syria. This demonstrates that officials did at least sometimes serve the same position more than once, and is a good reason to believe that Quirinius was actually twice in a position of command. Taking this into account, along with the fact that Luke over and over got minute details correct and has proven himself to be a reliable historian, the totality of this evidence offers a perfectly reasonable solution in regard to the timing of Quirinius's governing.
There is the mistake, in which case in chapter 6, verse 14, where Herod is referred to as King Herod. But he was tetrarch, he was not a king.
Mark 6:14 uses the word basileus, and it is defined by Strong's to refer to someone sovereign, whether abstractly, relatively, or figuratively. Thus, Herod Antipas as tetrarch was sovereign in the sense that he was one of four rulers over a region. Semantic flexibility in regard to titles of power was common. In fact, here are two examples in support of this. Not only does Mark refer to Herod the Tetrarch as king, but so does Matthew in chapter 14 of his gospel. He refers to Herod as Tetrarch in verse 1, but then in verse 9 he refers to Herod as king. So as petty ruler, he could rightfully be called king as a general term and Tetrarch as the technical term. Luke employs the same flexibility in regard to the title of Pilate, who was technically a prefect, not simply a governor. This was common practice. In fact, Josephus, the Jewish historian, repeatedly uses hegemon, the same word Luke used for Pilate, to describe Pilate and his predecessors in the same position. And Tacitus, the Roman historian, describes Pontius Pilate as, quote, one of our procurators, unquote. So, from the examples of Matthew 14, Luke, Josephus, and Tacitus, we see a certain amount of semantic flexibility in the use of these terms was common at that time.
So there's another problem as well. It makes it even worse. I have my notes here. That's why I'm looking at it. In Mark chapter 6, verse 19, Herod is said to have married his brother's wife. So his brother Philip has a wife called Herodias. Now, three verses later in chapter 6, verse 22, she's referred to as his daughter. So in the space of three verses, and anyone can check this, it goes from being his wife to his daughter, And the textual critics and the commentators writing in the NET say, yes, this is a significant historical error. I find that, did you guys know that? She goes from being his wife to his daughter, and we're the ones that apparently don't understand the Bible.
Notice how Ijaz, in desperation, cherry-picks a variant reading from an uncommon translation, the NET, in order to deceive his gullible Muslim audience. But let me share contradictory evidence that Ijaz conveniently left out. Whose daughter danced for Herod? Was it his own daughter or the daughter of Herodias? Number one, context makes it clear it was his wife's daughter, not his own. All one has to do is read two more verses, verse 24, which says, she went out and said to her mother, she, the daughter, said to her mother Herodias. So context makes it clear, daughter is not Herodias, but the daughter of Herodias. Number two, when we look at rival variant readings found in Mark 6:22, we see a vast amount that support this rendering. Number three, the Tyndale House edition of the Greek New Testament reads, the daughter of Herodias herself, and many compilations of the Greek New Testament agree with the reading of the Tyndale House edition at this point. Four, the first century historian Josephus stated, quote, Herodias took it upon herself to confound the laws of our country and divorced herself from her husband while he was still alive and was married to Herod Antipas, unquote. Notice Josephus makes it clear Herodias was Herod's wife, not daughter. Lastly, textual scholar James Snap Jr., in his article regarding this variant, stated it was not plausible that Herodias was Herod's daughter, as context makes it clear and affirms in verse 24 the dancer was Herodias' daughter. So, once again, Ijaz is refuted and is yet to provide a valid objection without including fallacies and deception.
In chapter 3, verse 2, when it says, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas. Now, high priesthood is singular, and Annas was the priest, high priest until 15 CE. Caiaphas would have been the priest at the time of Jesus. And so the question is strange, because if Jesus did begin his ministry around this time, then there's a 15-year difference. And this is at the start of Luke chapter 3. And I realized when I looked at it, the NET Bible says it's strange that it's a singular the priesthood. Only one person could be the high priest at any one point in time. So Annas was 15 years before Caiaphas. Caiaphas is his son-in-law. So the question stands out on the terms of the time scale and when events happened, because at the start from verse 1, he starts giving historical information during the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea and Herod was the tetrarch of Galilee. He gives us all of these historical details, but the one detail that's relevant to Judea, specifically who the high priest was at this time, he gets wrong. So it's strange that he, as the historian, makes this error, and very few Christians comment on it.
The Jews apparently accommodated Roman interference by speaking of both the current Roman appointee and the original rightly appointed Jewish priest as high priest. In fact, Professor John W. Lawrence, in his book, The Six Trials of Jesus, on page 63, says, quote, now the law made the office of high priest a lifetime position, but the Romans had forced Annas to give up the position, at least theoretically, for they felt it invested too much authority in one man for too long a time. This made the situation where there were, in fact, two high priests. Annas was still looked upon by Judaism as the true high priest as far as the law was concerned. Caiaphas was the high priest that same year in which Jesus Christ was tried as far as the Romans were concerned. Furthermore, Josephus himself uses the same language in the Jewish War, Book 2, Chapter 12, Section 6. One of them, high priest for life in Jewish eyes, the other, the guy that the Romans acknowledged as high priest. It's ironic E.F. Dawa is testing the historicity of the Gospels, as it appears they have not even bothered to look at the historicity of the claims they are making. So far, we are seeing the issue is not biblical at all, but rather a matter of poor reading comprehension and lazy research.
The second problem is, I am not aware of anyone within the four Gospels that does refer to Jesus as Emmanuel. I could be wrong. Brother Nazem, are we aware of anyone in the four Gospels that calls Jesus Emmanuel, and he responds to that name? Because it does say, and they will name him Emmanuel. Mm-hmm. which means God with us. I do recall that there's a variant here in that his family are the one that will call him Emmanuel. Of course, they did not do so. The other variant, which is present in the text here, is that they, that is the people, will call him Emmanuel. And frankly, we do not see that within his lifetime. So that is a bit confusing.
The answer is quite simple. In scripture, to be called often meant the same as shall be. For example, when God said that Eve shall be called woman, he did not mean that woman would be her name, but that by nature she was a woman. And it's also similar to how Jesus, who was to be called a Nazarene, was not literally called Nazarene, but that he exemplified a particular characteristic of Nazareth. So when Matthew quoted the Messianic prophecy of Isaiah 7:14 and testified that the people shall call his name Emmanuel, Matthew 1:23, he simply meant that by nature the Son of Mary was Emmanuel, meaning God with us, which he undoubtedly exemplified throughout his earthly ministry, such as him being worshipped throughout the Gospels and him being ascribed prophecies about Yahweh and being called Hatheas, such as we see in John 20:28.
Move on, inshallah. The Gospel of John has said to have 21 chapters. There's just one problem here. Scholars generally accept, and I think Nazim can support me on this one, that the Johannine prologue, you know, that God was the Word and he was with, sorry, that the Word was God and God, sorry, the Word was God and that the Word was with God, right? John chapter 1, the first 18 verses, they traditionally believe this actually came by a later editor inserted into the text, because John, whoever wrote this document from chapter 1 to chapter 20, they say chapter 21 is a later addition, because John chapter 20 ends with the purpose of the book. You don't write that unless you're at the end of the book or at the start. In this case, it's at the end. So we know that chapter 21 was by a later author.
John 20, 30-31 reveals John's purpose in writing this gospel, but it was not recorded as a summary statement. These two verses are actually the latter part of a flow of thought beginning several verses prior in John 19:35. Also, a parallel example of John 20, 30, and 31 can be seen in 1 John 5:13. But notice here, the letter does not terminate at this verse, but continues on for 8 more verses before it finally concludes. In other words, we do have supporting scriptures demonstrating that purpose statements did not necessarily signify a letter's immediate termination. Moreover, the Nesi Allen 28 critical edition, which Ijaz possesses, lists no manuscript of John which omits chapter 21. Also, early manuscripts such as P66 and P109 include chapter 21, and we also have a reference from Tertullian found in Adversus Praxian. Lastly, scholars like Paul S. Manier provide a great contextual argument for the authenticity of chapter 21. In his article titled The Original Functions of John 21, on pages 91 and 92, he states, quote, "I am convinced that only in chapter 21 do we discover an adequate end to the story of the two disciples who, from chapter 13 on, have played the most conspicuous role in the gospel, Simon Peter and the beloved disciple. They had left the stage in chapter 20, verse 10, following an episode that can best be termed indecisive," unquote. And again, quote, "In any case, their prominence in the story from chapter 13, verse 1 to chapter 20, verse 10, combined with the silence about them in chapter 20, verses 11 through 31, leaves the narrative about them strangely inconclusive, that is, unless the evangelists plan from the beginning to include the material of chapter 21. One function of chapter 21, therefore, is to provide an edifying end to the story of these two men," unquote. So again, Ijaz is wrong. There is early manuscript evidence and references from early writings demonstrating chapter 21's original presence, and there is parallel passages of purpose statements introduced prior to a letter's termination, proving there is no reason to reject whatever else comes afterwards, and as we have just seen, there is solid contextual evidence showing the gospel is adequately complete only with the inclusion of chapter 21.
If you read the King James Bible, the red letter Bible, mm-hmm. Now this is... obviously, if it's in red letters, this is apparently the words Jesus spoke. Mm-hmm. And in the red letter King James Bible, 3:16 is in red, right? Right. In the NIV red letter Bible, it's in black, right? And I watched a movie, The Gospel of John. Uh-huh. Yeah. So the part where he's talking to Nicodemus about this part, yeah. Mm-hmm. And the part about so God so loved the world, is spoken by the narrator. So, no, I don't believe Jesus spoke these words.
I want everyone to notice the subject of Iyadawa's critique pertains to historicity or historicity of the gospel text, but John 3:16 is not a variant reading, and so its authenticity is not disputed by scholars at all. In other words, this is not an issue of historicity. Rather, E.F. Dawa is simply criticizing a Bible Translation Committee's decision on using the color red or black, in which case, regardless of whatever color a modern translation may be, the historicity of the Greek text is not affected one bit or called into question at all. This is the epitome of desperation.